Thank you. Yeah, my theme tonight is the struggle for the fourth liberation is underway. I think those who talk of the third, somebody talked of the third, I think they forgot the new constitution is the third. Well, the second was the multipartism, the struggle for multipartism. And the first one, of course, you all know. So this is the fourth one. That is my theme. And one of my favorite historians, Eric Hobsbawm, has concluded a world risks both explosion and implosion. It must change. I'm sure a lot of you have heard me repeat this because it's true. Well, as Kenyans, we are part of that world and we must change. And how do we make sure that Kenya does not both explode and implode? And what is the role of civil society organizations, movements, and activists who are gathered here? When I met the academics the other day, I used the terms rebels, reformers, and revolutionaries. But I should have, tonight, I should have added the element of global solidarity. For those of you who don't know this history, when we started the Human Rights Commission, the people who came to our aid were embassies from Scandinavian countries and Holland, Canada, and the Ford Foundation. And we always remember that. Of course, that global solidarity still exists. When I go to be Chief Justice, the capacity of that office, I always say, was two secretaries and eight bodyguards. And it's from my friends from Holland and the Scandinavian countries, Ford Foundation again, Canadians, and this time the other development partners that we were able to get, that capacity. But how do we change? I think in this country, after decades of struggles to reach, we reached a consensus in 2010 when we promulgated the Constitution. And I've always argued that the vision of the Constitution is the building of a social democratic state and society. And there are many pillars that the Constitution has erected as the basis of permanent foundation for such a state and society. And if you read quickly the Constitution, you see them. Even those who are against the Constitution have read them. And if you have watched carefully, they are busy dismantling those pillars. And I've said the struggle to implement our progressive constitution is a fourth liberation. And nobody in this gathering has been sleeping through this struggle. And I believe I'm preaching to the converted. The burning question is what you have been doing to breathe life in our constitution and thereby participate intellectually, ideologically, and politically in its successful implementation. In these few remarks, I'm not about to undertake an interrogation of what gains you have made and what challenges you continue to face. I'm sure the organizations and movements and activists gathered here have done that. What I'll do quickly is to share five spaces or bases that exist to be occupied in the struggle to implement the Constitution. First one is, let's pay close attention to the emerging grassroots activism in the counties. That activism is loud and clear around the equitable distribution of resources and the promotion and protection of human rights. Have paid close attention to my county of Kitui, And I believe the anti-corruption movement is starting in the marginalized counties where citizens are demanding more resources and are paying close attention to what they have been given. In our case in Kitui, the governor told me the other day that the money we have received since the promulgation of the constitution is 2,000 times the amount of money we have received since independence. And I'm sure that Mandela would probably give other stories, Wajir, Turkana. And that's the beginning. Now, the second space or base that we should pay close attention to is the 2017 election. Maybe the first one where some clear issues take root. These include the devolution of political power and resources, and that one is still ongoing. The role of Treasury in controlling resources at the behest of the central government, and you know that governors and the central government are debating that every day. The restructuring of governance structures at national and county governments, the emergence of human rights movements on housing, clean water, quality education, food, clean environment, and gender equity, among others. And I believe the election itself will raise issues of leadership and integrity as candidates try to kill off their opponents by invoking Chapter 6. I know you may think there is an elite consensus to bury that chapter, but I urge you to watch that space. The possibility of building a permanent bridge between the middle class organizations, movement, and activists with their grassroots compatriots is the real and must be taken up so that you build strong organizations, movements, and cadres of activists that express the social democratic voice in the country. We all know, and those of you who don't know, get informed tonight, 80% of the population of this country is under 35 years of age. I know you follow the pollsters, on what they see as a vision of the youth. I cannot agree that vision as projected by them as homogeneous. What I see is a youth that has started to imagine its material interests, again from the margins of the counties. The agitation for the right to work, the right to quality education, the right to housing, sanitation, and clean environment, and the right to food and health. All these struggles are visible in counties, and this space is worth serious ideological and political attention. And the fifth space, because I'm only going to mention five spaces, there are many more. The search for alternative leaderships from the grassroots to the center is an issue I see clearly. Whether it is the judicial challenge on leadership and integrity, or the slow pace of the media in focusing on the issue of exposing the theft by religious shepherds from their respective flocks, or whether it's the exposure of corruption and the raiding of people's resources, and the lack of elite consensus on the state, the country they wish to rule going forward. All these issues you should pay special attention to. Lastly, on the issue of whether I'm coming back to the civil society, I don't know why that is an issue. Reminds me of a story from Uganda, which I'm sure some of you have heard me tell, of this guy who formed a political party in Uganda, and the mission of that party was to get the British back. He wanted the British back, I'm sure maybe he thought that, you know, the conditions in Uganda after the British left were unbearable and he wanted the British back. Anyway, he lost, he got two votes, and he was, very worried why. And he asked his wife what happened. The wife told him that he must be an idiot, the British never left. So, I never left the civil society. And the question of going back doesn't arise. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Winnie Mutunga, for your sentiments that you've shared with us. I'd now like to call upon the Anna Gishego of KHRC and Davis Malombe to bring forward the gift that we have for Dr. Winnie Mutunga. Thank you.